Well, hey, welcome to Chi Alpha. And like I said at the beginning, we love that you are here. We love that you get to spend the next 20 minutes with us. It goes by fast. Chi Alpha goes by real fast. So if you're thinking, man, where have I gotten myself? We'll be done real quick, so it won't be that bad. Yeah, we were talking about small groups, and I think a lot of small groups started this week. I know we had ours last night out at the river. It was awesome. Isaac was there. Man, we got like torn up by mosquitoes. So we were like all itching last night. It was crazy. But we sent a fire pit sailing down the river. That was pretty funny. Crazy stuff. Jaden almost broke his neck jumping off of a dead tree. So that was cool. Not really. But we had a lot of fun. I'm really excited about camping. I just want to say, like, I'm really excited about camping. If you live in Colorado and you're not into camping, like wake up. Like, we have like the best camping in the entire world. Okay, so we're gonna go up to this spot. It's in the mountains. It's actually a secret spot. Not a lot of people know about it. The reason we found this spot is because several years ago in Chi Alpha, we were camping in an illegal spot, and a park ranger found us. And he was like, listen, guys, you can't camp here, but I'll show you where you can. And he took us out to this like super secret place. It's not labeled or anything, which is why we're carpooling, because if I drop a pin and give it to you, you're going to get lost. So, but it's an awesome spot. It's free. You guys should come. It's just a little plug there. But so last week, we kind of began the semester talking about kind of the most important questions in life that we can ask ourselves. Last week, we talked about who am I? And we talked a little bit about like what Chi Alpha is, but more importantly, we talked about who are you, right? What are you? What are you supposed to be? What were you made to be, right? And we talked about love, and we talked about how love is a choice, not a feeling, right? And so even when somebody treats you terribly, you can still choose to love them. We talked about choosing to love the unlovable. We talked about how God loves us in this way. And if we turn our backs on God, he still waits for us with open arms. We talked about that too. We talked about the idea of intrinsic value. Do you remember this? This idea that we as human beings, each of us have a value that cannot be added to or taken away from, right? So no matter what condition a person is in, they are valuable. And we talked about that. Good start to the semester. But tonight we're going to attempt to answer another one of these amazing questions, and this question we're going to answer is, why am I here? Another way to say this is, what is my purpose? And I like to go even deeper and say, what is the meaning of life? You can say it that way too. Why am I here? What is my destiny? We know that on this earth, we only have about a 75 to 80 year dance in the sun, and then it's all over, right? On average. Woo, somebody went woo. And that's all we know for sure. And a lot of us go, well, surely that can't be it, right? Like, if that's all there is, then why am I doing the things that I'm doing, right? Why am I striving for an education? Why am I looking to get a job, right? I'm just going to, you know, I'm going to make all this money, and it's not really going to matter because I'm going to die anyway. So what's the point? Dang, Duncan, we're going pretty deep. It's like, yes, we are. This is what we do in Chi Alpha. We like to go deep. We don't like to keep it surface level. We're not just about fun and games. We actually try to break apart life's mysteries, okay? So let's talk about this. Now, men and women throughout the ages have attempted to answer this question, right? You study philosophy, you study history. People have always tried to answer this question. Why are we here? What is the purpose of life? Right? And nobody credible has like gone to the other side and come back and said, here's what's to come, right? At least there's been some fanatics that's happened to, but we don't pay attention to them, right? There's been false prophets that have come forward and say, the world's going to end on August, or what was it? Was this December 21st, 2012 was like the last one, right? Me and one of my small group guys that year brought in that day drinking Dr. Peppers and wearing sombreros, and nothing happened. So that was false. Yeah, that's what we do. The ancient Athenian philosopher Plato supposed that the meaning of life was to pursue the highest form of knowledge, the knowledge of good, and so as to contribute to the ultimate happiness of the individual and society. Thank you, Wikipedia. I just quoted that. Friedrich Nietzsche surmised that ultimately life is meaningless And therefore, the only reason for someone to keep living is if they have a goal in mind that they believe was valuable, right? So if you've got some, and according to him, if you've got something you think is worth living for, then you've got a reason to live, but ultimately it's meaningless. Because value is subjective, and therefore nothing really has value. Okay, you following me? We're going to go, what? Don't worry, it gets easier. Even King Solomon, I Googled King Solomon. Apparently, that's what he looked like. I guess. I don't know. I wasn't there. King Solomon, he's in the Bible. Even the guy, this guy in the Bible, considered one of the wisest men that ever lived, surmised in Ecclesiastes 1, he declares meaningless, meaningless, utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. There is nothing new under the sun, right? This is what King Solomon says. And I will even admit to you tonight that if there is no meaning to life, then everything I have strived for really has no purpose. Some might say, well, you can contribute to society and make others better. But then I say in return, but if life is meaningless, why does that have value to them? Right? If everything is meaningless, then nothing has value. So we ask ourselves this question: why do we do the things we do, and who do we do them for? This is the most important question a human being can ask themselves. Why do I do the things I do, and who do I do them for? Like, if I was a tattoo person, this would be tattooed on my face, right? Actually, I wanted to get a tattoo of my face on my face, but a centimeter off, so I looked blurry. But that never happened. But why do I do the things I do, and who do I do them for? Now, we're going to attempt to answer this in the next 15 minutes, and we're not going to be able to do justice, but might I encourage you to go to small group, because in small groups, they will unpack this even more throughout the year. Why do I do the things I do, and who do I do them for? So let's start in the Bible. We said this last week, that if God, assuming God created us, I don't know where everybody's at in here, I don't want to pretend to assume, but assuming God created us, I would venture to say he has something to say about this, okay? So let's see what he says. In the Gospel of John, chapter 3, we actually see one of the most profound scriptures in all of Christianity. They've probably become the most quoted words in all of history. And if you've ever been part of a church or a Christian group, or if you've watched big pink-haired ladies on TBN, you've probably heard this verse. And the verse goes like this: "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." Right? John 3:16. We've all heard that, right? I think we've all heard that. Pretty common. I used to be a WWE fan, and I was a big Stone Cold Steve Austin fan. He would have Austin 3:16. Remember that? Anybody remember that? No, I'm too old. Because Stone Cold said so. That's what he said. But there's a reason that this verse is quoted so often. And as a Christian, I believe that the meaning of life and our ultimate goal is found in this statement. This verse declares that there is a God, and then answers what this God is like. Okay? Not that he's just this distant God that doesn't care about us, but that there is one, and that he is concerned with us, and even that he loves us, right? I mean, this is actually a pretty loaded statement, that there is a God and that he loves us. That's huge. Then it supposes that God has a son, and that God sent his son Jesus for what? Well, we get into that. God sent his only son, and whoever believes in his son will not die, but live forever. That's a loaded statement. I mean, theologians have been having a basket case over this for centuries. This is often referred to as the good news. The good news, the gospel, right? This is the good news to humanity. But why? Now, I shared last week I haven't always been a Christian. I am a Christian now, but I became a Christian when I was 18. And before that, I would always break down these scriptures and I would say, why? Why is that important? Why is that important to me? Why is this good news? So to answer this, we have to look back at creation. We said that last week, that God created us. Not only did he create us, but he created us in his image. You remember we talked about that, right? He created us in his image. This is what gives us our value and our worth. And let's take that. Let's say we believe that. Let's say we can see what I believe is the obvious holes, the glaring holes in Darwinism and things like that, which we can get into another time. I love talking about that stuff as a former believer in that stuff. But let's say God created us, but why? Some religions attempt to answer this by saying that maybe God was lonely, right? That he needed a friend. So he created people to be friends with, right? I don't believe that, because I believe that God is self-sufficient, that the Trinity, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit have had fellowship for eternity, and they have perfect fellowship, so they didn't need us. So it wasn't out of some need that God had that he created us. Others have suggested that God created us to bow down and worship him and submit to his will, and that's our only purpose. I had a really dear atheist friend of mine a couple years ago, and he said this. He said this, and I quote, "Why does God need us to worship him? Isn't that a little conceited of him? Isn't that a little insecure of him?" That was actually a great question, right? Why does God need us to worship him? That's a great question. I answered, no, God does not need us to worship him. It's not like if we don't worship him, he's going to sit on his throne and pout, right? King Nebuchadnezzar did this in the book of Daniel, and he had this problem, and these three Hebrew boys would not bow down and worship the king, so he had them thrown into the furnace to be burnt alive. Spoiler alert, they lived. But this isn't how God is. We don't worship him to fulfill some need he has, okay? So why did God create us? What is our purpose? So in Chi Alpha, we have a very simple statement that we believe sums up our purpose, and it's this statement right here. Our purpose is to have a relaxed love relationship with God. Our purpose is to have a relaxed love relationship with God. Why were we created? This is the answer. This is the best answer I can come up with. We are the logical result, us, everyone here, everyone on planet Earth, is the logical result of a loving God. We are the result of the love that God has and has always had. We are the fruit, if you will, of the relationship that God has. We aren't here to fulfill a need of his. We aren't here as some byproduct of some world building that he started, right? Like Minecraft. I have so many Minecraft worlds that I started and I haven't, you know, like I go back and open them. Oh yeah, I forgot. It's not that, right? Like I'm world building and I made some people and I moved on. That's what deism is. We don't believe that in Chi Alpha. We believe that we were created to walk with God, to have a relaxed love relationship with God. We say this, it was for our sake that we were created. We're the ones that need God. And let me say this for you, those of you here tonight that do not have a walk with God, the reason that you have felt so unfulfilled in life is because this is why you were created and you aren't living up to that, right? I mean, that's just the honest truth. This is what I learned about myself. It's like buying a border collie as a pet, right? Anybody got a border collie here? I love border collies. If you buy a border collie but then just keep it inside all day and it becomes lazy and fat, that dog is miserable because that dog was bred to herd sheep all day, right? So if you were created for a purpose, but you aren't living up to that purpose, you're going to feel really unfulfilled. Does that make sense? I hope it does. Some people live for money and wealth. Maybe that's why you're getting a college degree. That's what I was living for. Can I just tell you this? That some of the richest people I know in the world are some of the most miserable. Okay? Money might bring you temporary pleasure, but ultimately it does not bring you any joy. I've heard it put this way, that some people are so poor all they have is money. True riches do not come from money. I've lived long enough to say that. Some of you here might have grown up in church like I did, but have never had your own walk with God. Maybe your only walk with God has been through your parents. Maybe it's just been because you've always gone to church and that's just what you do. But now you're in college and you have to figure out what you actually believe. That's a big deal, right? We call this walking vicariously through something else, right? So you may have been a Christian, right? I'm putting quotes around that, but you didn't really have a walk with God. You just said you did because you went to church, right? Your purpose is to have your own daily, real, deep, personal relationship with God. And we're going to have some time to get into that tonight at the end. So what does this practically look like? When we say relationship with God, we mean exactly that. Relationship. I use this term walk with God a lot, right? That's just a way to say a relationship with God. You're supposed to have a walk with God. So how do you know if you have a relationship with somebody? It's that you spend time with them, right? It's pretty simple. If you have a relationship with somebody, you spend time with them. If you stick long enough with us through the semester, you're going to have a chance to hear my amazing wife, Lori, preach. Okay, here's a picture of her. She's awesome. Man, she's amazing. She's doing some childcare tonight. All of us on staff have kids, and so we take turns watching each other's kids. But you'll hear her preach. And by the way, in Chi Alpha, this is just a little nugget. I say nugget a lot. A nugget is just something that, here's a little factoid. But in Chi Alpha, we believe in women preachers. Okay? Some churches don't believe in that. Some churches believe that the pulpit is only for a man. Well, we don't believe that. We believe in the ordination of women, that women have just as much to say about God as anybody. So you'll hear my wife preach, and she's an amazing preacher. But the reason I bring her up is because she and I have been married for 12 years. We've known each other for 18 years. And I can tell you that the reason we have lasted this long is because we spend time together, right? We protect our time together. You know, it would be like if I got married to Lori, right? And all I ever did was talk about her, but I never actually spent time. Like, all I did was buy her stuff, and then I would talk about her to other people. But if I never actually spent time with her, I would have no relationship with her. Does that make sense? Yeah. It's the same with God. Like, a lot of people love to talk about God, right? A lot of people in the church love to talk about God. But unless you spend time with him, you have no relationship with him. Let me say this. Relationships take maintenance. Okay? Relationships take maintenance. Do you agree with that? Real relationships take maintenance. In order to walk with God, you have to have a relationship with him. Now, this seems pretty simple. If I'm going to follow Jesus, I should probably know the person that I claim to follow. Okay? But this can be one of the most neglected things in our life. If we go back to the verse we just read, John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life." That word believe is actually a loaded term. That word believe. It's too busy of a term to just skip by it, okay? Remember, the Bible wasn't written in English originally. Remember, we talked about that last week. The word believe is actually this word right here. It comes from the Greek word pistuo, okay? Pistuo. What'd you say? Pistachio. Close. Pistuo, which actually means to have a strong conviction, okay? So believe isn't just meaning, oh, I think something exists, like I think there are blue teapots in the world. That's not believe. Believe is to have a strong conviction. And when you have a strong conviction about something, it actually causes you to live a certain way. Okay? So if you say you believe in something, you're going to live as if it's true. If you believe that if you jump off a cliff into the Grand Canyon, if you believe that that's going to kill you and you don't want to die, what aren't you going to do? You aren't going to jump off the cliff, right? So that means you believe in that, right? That's a belief of yours. That's what this. That's why I said this word is a loaded term, pistuo. So if you say believe in Jesus, but do not live as if it's true, you don't actually believe in him, okay? Oh my gosh, that's huge, right? We got to move on for the sake of time. So what is all this for? Okay, Duncan, you've convinced me that my purpose is to have a relaxed love relationship with God. But why? Why do I need a walk with God? I'm doing just fine without him. Okay? Why do I need a walk with God? That's actually a very good question. It's a valid question. I'm not one to just dismiss questions because they're tough questions. Okay? So if you ever, in Chi Alpha, if you ever have a hard question that you're afraid to ask, please ask one of us because we like those questions. And if we don't know the answer, we're going to seek them out with you. And that's what small group is for. Okay? Okay, we are not afraid of questions. So why do I need a walk with God? And I will answer it this way. Because ultimately, you are an eternal soul that will last forever. You are an eternal soul that will last forever. That's why you need a walk with God. Like this rotting bag of meat right here will cease to work one day, right? That's kind of like what we all are, right? Actually, I think most of you are still on the uphill. I think it's when you get to like 28. Is that what it is? 28, you start to, right? So y'all got, yeah, there you go. It will stop working one day. Now, I'm not one of these preachers that wants to make you afraid of that so you'll convert to a certain religion. I'm not into that, okay? I'm not into scaring people into the kingdom of God. That's not how Jesus did it. That's not how I do things, okay? Or any of us here. But we do know that the Bible speaks about heaven and hell. Duncan, you just went there on the second week? Yeah, the Bible talks about heaven and hell. And if somebody scares somebody, you know, like let's say, oh my gosh, if you don't become a Christian, you're going to burn in hell forever. I better become a Christian then. Well, then you just became a Christian for a selfish reason, right? That's not why we become Christians. Does that make sense? We don't become Christians because we're afraid of hell, okay? Because that's selfish in nature. Does that make sense? Like, I don't want a Christianity that revolves around me, okay? So I'm not into that. But I will say this, each one of us has a destiny in eternity. And each one of us will spend eternity with God or without God. And that's just a reality. But if we've been talking about relationships, this should make sense. And this shouldn't come as a surprise. Because if we like being with God, we get to be with Him forever. If we don't like being with God, we don't have to be with Him ever again. Right? That's just the reality. There are those who will spend eternity without God, which the Bible describes as hell. And hell is not so much a place where, you know, these guys with horns poke you with pitchforks for eternity. That's not hell, right? A lot of that imagery comes from Dante's Inferno, not really the Bible, okay? And for some reason in history, we got those things mixed up. Hell is more of a place that God does not exist, right? And it's the realization that God is not there that causes torment. It's the realization of what I could have had, but I will never get, that brings on the torment, right? And Jesus refers to this law, a place where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth, right? That's his way of saying it is torment to know that God is not there and he never will be there. It is eternal separation from God. It is for those who don't want to have anything to do with God. It is a place for those who have knowingly rejected him, okay? Now think about it. I asked somebody, I said, well, how could a loving God send people to hell? It's not so much that a loving God sends people to hell. It's that people don't want to be with God, so he's made a place where he's not. Does that make sense? So it's not an unloving thing for someone to go to hell. It's just a place where he's not, and it causes torment. Okay. Now there's lots of descriptions of that torment, and we're not going to get into that tonight. We just don't have enough time. But hell is a destiny for those, even in the church, who do a great many good things for God, but never actually know God. I hope you heard that. That hell is also a place for people in the church who love serving God, but don't actually know him. Did you know that Jesus actually addresses these people? Duncan didn't just make this up. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, it says this. Jesus is talking here. He says, not everyone who says to me, now this is Jesus talking, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those who do the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out demons in your name and perform many miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, and he calls them evildoers. So only those who know God. The scary thing is that you can go your entire life doing great things for God, but not actually know him. Now, this should make sense to us, right? Like, in Colorado, for some reason, we're a very purple state politically. Like, everybody hates each other. I hope we can change that, by the way. I hate that it's like that politically. It's red, blue, red, you know, Democrat, Republican. We just go back and forth all the time. We're a swing state. But we, like, let's say the next political season comes around, and let's say that I just get really intrigued by one of the candidates, like, running for office. And let's say that I buy the t-shirt, and I buy the yard signs, and I go out and I run tables for this candidate, and I like, give glory to this guy, and I'm like, man, this guy should be in office, and here's all the great things he's done. You should become a voter for this guy, right? Let's say I do that. And then let's say this candidate wins and he throws a party. Is he going to invite me? He might, but is he going to know who I am? Absolutely not, unless I've taken the time to know this person. Okay, so for those of us here that are in the church, I'm addressing you now. For those of you that are in the church, be careful for doing too much for God that busies yourself too much to not give you enough time to get to know him. Evildoers that Jesus calls here are those who do great things for God but never actually slow down to get to know the one they think they're serving. So I want to end tonight by putting all this into perspective. I went a little bit deeper tonight. I know some of you are like shifting your chair. Man, this is uncomfortable. This is good news. We want to go deep in Chi Alpha. We want to search out the deeper things. If you stick with us through this year, we're going to cover things that a lot of people don't like to cover because we're not afraid of questions. Okay? When God created the universe, he created it perfectly. So what does this all mean for me? When God created the universe, he created everything perfectly. And after everything was formed, he made man and woman. He put them in creation. He told them to steward it, to take care of it. He told them to name the animals, right? And it was the human's job to have a walk with God. That was their only job. In fact, the Bible says that Adam, which was the first man, walked with God in the cool of the day, meaning that it was good. It was all right. It was relaxed, right? That's what this means right here. However, as many of us know, the story takes a turn because although man and woman were told to not eat of a certain fruit, they decided to rebel against what God said. And the creation rebelled. I say it this way. The creation rebelled against the Creator. And for those of you church kids, you're like, oh yeah, I know this story, right? Some people call this the fall of man. Like you might have a Bible translation where the paragraph is called the fall of man, right? I actually don't like that term because it's as if like man and woman were just walking through the garden, they tripped over a root, right? Oh crap, you know, like we made a mistake and we fell. It's not the fall of man. It actually should be called the rebellion of man, right? That's what C.S. Lewis says in a lot of his writings. It should be called the rebellion of man. Oh, yeah, I have a slide for that. It's in red. This broke God's heart. When it's red, it means change the slide. Sorry. The rebellion of man. Now, when man and woman rebelled, I want you to get something. When man and woman rebelled, this broke God's heart. He is a God of emotion. He has feelings. The most beautiful thing in all creation, us, right? Those who were created to walk with and love God rebelled against him. Many of us here tonight have had broken hearts before, and we know what that feels like. And at that very moment, God set into motion a plan to redeem us all. And for hundreds of years, God spoke this plan through people, you know, men and women who wrote this stuff down throughout the ages. And then it finally happens. John chapter 1 says that the Word, God, became flesh and dwelt among us, and his name is Jesus. Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, was sent to redeem us and save us from our sin and our rebellion. See, like was said, we were created to walk with God, but because of our sin, because of our rebellion, God's heart was broken. And it's impossible to have a love relationship with somebody who has broken your heart. It's impossible. I shared with you last week that I had been dating this girl and I found out she cheated on me. Right? She broke my heart. And at that moment, it was impossible for me to have a relationship with her. right? There'd be no way. Our sin and our rebellion is what separates us from God. Our sin and our rebellion is what separates us from God. It is what separates us from the walk that we were supposed to have. However, Jesus was sent with a purpose, not to be a prophet, not to be a good moral teacher, although he did those things. Jesus was sent to save us from the eternity that we were headed for. Does that make sense? Jesus was sent to save us from the eternity that we deserved. Now, you know the story. He was perfect. He led a sinless life. He taught mankind how to really have a walk with God. Then he was arrested and beaten and crucified on a cross to take on the punishment that we deserved. And remember, you and I were headed for eternity, void of God's presence. But Jesus changed all of that. And not only did he die the death that we deserve, but after 3 days in the grave, he was brought back to life. He awoke with the keys to the grave, and death itself was defeated forever. So not only did he pay the price that we were supposed to pay, he paid it for us, but then he goes ahead and he does a step extra and then beats death itself so that we don't have to die. You and I were prisoners. We were imprisoned behind walls that were never coming down. We were criminals who rebelled against our Creator. And there was no hope. But at the resurrection, the gates of that prison flew wide open. And everyone behind those gates were given the opportunity to be free. That's what we believe in Chi Alpha. We can be forgiven. Our slate can be wiped clean. We can become a new creation, free from rebellion, free from sin, if we put our conviction in what Jesus did for us. Remember, that whosoever shall believe, meaning we have a strong conviction, which causes us to live a certain way. If we put our conviction in that, we can be free. So what's the good news of the gospel? Right? I had somebody asked me this one time. He said, well, what's the good news of the, or I said, what's the good news of the gospel? And he said, well, that Jesus died. And I said, no, that's terrible news, right? What? That's terrible. Well, that he rose again. Well, that's great, but why is that good news for me? Great for him, but why is that good news for me? The good news is that I can be reconciled to God again. I can be set free. That's the good news of the gospel. So, just like last week, this is what we're going to do. Let's all stand together.